When you send data over the internet, how does it know how to get there? It uses a routing algorithm. Now, these algorithms might have different uses, but we want to explain a common example that's used. With the difference, we want to explain it simply. Also in this video, we're going to compare this Dijkstra's algorithm, this routing algorithm, with the uniform cost search that we've seen before to show why it's better. So let's have a look at the Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm. As you can see, there are different uses, but essentially what we're looking for is the optimized route, the minimum travel time and the shortest path. And it's this example that we're going to use with network routing, which is how packets get across the internet. Now we want to find the quickest or cheapest route from A to B, but there might be several ways to go. So we can use a graph to demonstrate how to get from the source to the destination. And here we see our common example that's used to explain routing algorithms. Now we're not going to go through all the definitions or the Dijkstra's algorithm that's explained at university in the same way, as it might be a bit confusing, as might going through the code that is also online. Let's look at the Dijkstra algorithm. Now we're going to use the same example, but instead of using letters, we're going to use numbers so we can look at the graph in a similar way as we have in our previous videos on other algorithms. You can see it's the same graph with the same nodes and the same weights and costs. Let's get started. We can go to 4, to 2, and to 3 with these costs. Now, what's the shortest path from 1? Well, quite simply, shortest path to 2 has a cost of 2, shortest path to 3 has a cost of 1, and the shortest path to 4 has a cost of 5. Now, that's quite straightforward. Now, what happens if we add more nodes? Well, the lowest cost we've had so far is a cost of 1, which was the distance or the cost of node 1 to node 3. So let's see if there's more of the graph we can reach from node 3. Okay, let's have a look. We go to node 2 with a cost of 2, and we can go to node 4 with a cost of 3. Also, a new node, node 5, with a cost of 1. Now let's look. Now these are the details we had before. Have they changed? We've got path to 2, cost of 2 is the same, there's no change. Path to 3, minimum cost 1, no change. But what about the path to 4? Well, we can go via node 3 with a cost of 4 rather than 5. So the route that we can take from node 1 to node 4 is actually quicker if we go via node 3. We've got the cost of 1 and 3, so a total cost of 4 rather than 5. Also, the path to 5, we've got a minimal cost of 2. And the route to node 5 is via node 3, so 1 to 3 to 5. Well, the lowest cost is 2, so we can either go from node 1 to 2 or node 1 to 3 to 5 and continue. So there's two options. Let's show these two options. So we're going to start off option 1, we go to node 2, and there's another option that we'll do later. So let's go from node 2 to see if there are other paths. So we can go to node 4 from node 2, and there's no change. So there's no change in our shortest path to any of the nodes. So lowest cost, let's try 5. So from node 5, we can go to node 4 with a cost of 1. A new node, node 6, with a cost of 2. Okay, let's see our minimal costs. Well, no change to 2, no change to node 3. Node 4, there is a change. We can go to node 4 in a cheaper path, a shorter path of 111, a total of 3 to node 4. So that's route 1, 3, actually it's 1, 3, 5 to 4. And also path 5, there's no change. And path 6, the minimal cost will be 4. So 1 + 1 + 2 is a cost of 4. Are there any more paths? Let's have a look. Okay, so we can go from node 4 to node 6 with a cost of 5. Now that doesn't change anything at all. We have the minimal costs. So we can see these. We have the different routes and we have the costs of these routes. So we can see that our numbers match the network that is the example that's commonly used. Now, these are normally written as the nodes as letters U, V, W, X, Y, and Z rather than numbers. So let's have a look at this. So you may have seen this table used for Dijkstra's algorithm. So this uses the second option of going via node 5. So let's have a look at that. So here's our network. We've got the step at the top. Can you remember? We've got the costs of 2. We've got the costs of 5, 2, and 1. So the cost to V is 2. The cost to W is 5. The cost to X is 1. So we can see here with the first step, or without the first step if you like, without moving from U, so there's just the route from U to V is 2, and it goes via, the last node was U. The route to W, cost of 5, last node was U. X, cost of 1, last node is U. And if we don't have any path, we can say that's infinite because we have no finite cost. So that is what this table means. So in the next step, let's have a look what happens. We've got X to V, X to W, X to Y. So now our route is from X, from U to X and to V, we've still got 2. To W, we've now got 4, so we've changed from 5 to 4, and the last node is X, not U. So when we want to get to W, we go via X, not straight from U, with a cost of 4. So you can see that's the lowest cost. Now, we've actually already travelled 1, so we're not going to get a cost lower than 1, so we can say the cost to X, that is the shortest path. We've already confirmed that because we're not going to get shorter than 1. And Y is a new node we can add to our table via X with a cost of 2. So that's what the table means. Okay, let's have a look at the next stage. So here we're going via Y because we have a cost of 2 here. And where does Y go? What Y goes to W and it goes to Z. So, U, X, Y. So, V hasn't changed. W now has a root of 3 via Y. So, we've changed that. Y also, we can confirm that 2 is the minimal cost, which this says. And Z, now we have this cost of 4. We can go through the remaining connections between the nodes, the edges, and we can see we're just confirming the shortest steps until we get to the final step, which we check C, which doesn't have any new edges, new connections. So we can see if we want to draw a graph similar to the diagram, you can see we still have the same result as we've just explained. Okay. So that's our graph with either letters or numbers and our simple example. Now let's have a look at the code. In our code, we have a class called graph, and inside that we define the functions initialization, to print, the distances, between the nodes, and here's our Dijkstra algorithm defined. So that's our Dijkstra algorithm code. We also put the graph into an adjacency matrix, and then we run our code. When we run it, you can see the results, the vertices, the nodes, and the minimal distances, the least cost. So the main part here that we need to explain is, how did we define our graph, looking back at our slides? Well, we defined our network by using an adjacency matrix. So you can see this matrix. We've got node 1. Now, that doesn't have any cost to itself, but it has a cost of 3 when it goes to node 2, cost of 4 when it goes to node 3, and a cost of 2 when it goes to node 4. So we can put in all of the costs. Whenever a node is connected to another one, we put in the cost. And if it's not connected, like for example to itself, then we just put in 0. So that's how we can define the graph that we're using with Dijkstra's algorithm. So you can see in this example, you can see, for example, node 1 doesn't have a cost to itself, then 2 to node 2, then 1 to node 3, then 5 to node 4, for example. So you can see for each node, we have the costs to the other 6 nodes. That's in our graph, and that's how we define it. And in the code, we had our class graph with the different functions, including the Dijkstra function that calculates our minimal costs. Now let's have a look at Dijkstra's algorithm versus the uniform cost search that we've looked at previously. But it doesn't guarantee the shortest path. So here's our example, and we can see that we can go through these different paths to find the shortest or the least cost or the shortest path with our uniform cost search. But in this example, what it does, it looks for node 1, node 3, node 4 with a cost of 4, but it doesn't continue in searching. So there is actually another cost, another path that's less. So uniform cost search iteratively looks through the numbers in order in our network, but it doesn't necessarily backtrack all of the paths. So it can miss out on a shorter or least cost path when we're going through our network. So let's have a look at another example here. We've got a network we've used in previous videos. We want to know the shortest path to each of the nodes. So for example, to node 7, we can go through 1 to 5 to 7, which has a cost of 3. Quite straightforward. Let's have a look at Dijkstra's algorithm, and let's have a look at the code. We have the same code as we used before. You can see we have the class graph, we have our functions defined, and now we have our new graph with 10 nodes, 10 vertices, and if we run the code, you can see the distances, the shortest path from the source to each node. Back to our slides, you can see our graph and the results of the shortest costs to each node. Lowest cost, the shortest path. Again, with uniform cost search, we can have an error. For example, here we found the node 9 with a cost of 12 because that's the quickest route when going in order. So 1 to 3 to 6 to 9 would be a cost of 12. But actually, there's a cost of 8, 1 to 5 to 7 to 10, and then back to 9. So we'd only find that using Dijkstra. So I hope you understand Dijkstra's algorithm now. Well, if you did and you gained some information, please click the like. That helps us and gets our videos suggested more on YouTube. And if you haven't already, please subscribe. I hope you enjoyed this series on algorithms, And we'll continue next with the A-star search. Soon.